ANA has chosen to take action. And I think that's incredibly bold and brave.
We need to have more social awareness.
If you look into it, we have a solution. So let's make a difference.
I'm here today in Tokyo at the headquarters of All Nippon Airways, where I'm joined by two members of ANA's decarbonization team in their corporate planning department, Mr. Kohei Yoshikawa, who's a director in the decarbonization team, and Ms. Satoko Arima, who's an assistant manager on the team. We're here today to talk about some of the challenges and opportunities faced in decarbonizing aviation and how direct air capture can play a role in helping aviation to reach net zero. You know, we know that the aviation sector is incredibly challenging to decarbonize.
Yes.
Can you speak to part of what makes it so hard to decarbonize?
Mm-hmm. So the industry, this industry is in the one of the hard to abate sectors. As you can see that we and also other airlines already started focusing on creating the strategy to decarbonize and then challenging to the climate solutions.
I've always found ANA's portfolio approach to be particularly inspiring, recognizing how all of the different pieces come together. Your combinations of investments in efficiency together with sustainable aviation fuel, and then recognizing that there will still be residual emissions.
Yes.
And the leadership that you have shown in choosing to use direct air capture to sequestration or carbon removal to address your residual emissions, I think is tremendous.
Yeah.
Your 2050 plan highlights that you will need removals to counterbalance your residual emissions. Can you speak to what made you decide to take action today?
I understand that there's no silver bullet in decarbonizing aviation. And my previous role was in the jet fuel procurement part of our company. And I spent so many years in introducing SAF into a regular operation. And as we go deeper into the characteristics of sustainable aviation fuel, we realize that there's always going to be a residual emissions. So I think it's going to be a flip side of the same coin. And even though we replace 100% of our jet fuel with sustainable aviation fuel, there is always residual emissions. So just like you mentioned, to counterbalance that residual emission, we will definitely need negative emissions technologies, which is reflected in our decarbonization transition strategy. And the reason why we need to start today is that it's like a cross-sectoral collaboration, which is outside of the aviation industry, which is going to take some time to build momentum. And also we understand it is really going to take time to research and develop new technologies. And think about 2050 is going to be, I can say we have 27 years more, but at the same time, we can say we only have 27 years. So there is no need to stop and think about it, but to take action today.
That's fantastic. And thank you for taking action today.
Yeah.
When you think about your decarbonization strategy, and I know ANA released their midterm environmental plan that had to respond to the changes in ICAO and the CORSIA regulations, can you speak to, you know, between now and 2050, how are you weighing the different risks and opportunities of your transition plan?
Biggest challenge for us is to balance the two conflict elements, we believe. The one is, as an operator of aircraft, we would like to expand our network. And on the other hand, we would like to curb the CO2 emissions. So these two elements are pretty much conflicting. By 2030, as our corporate strategy, we will reduce more than 10% emissions on both international and domestic flights. The public sector and private sector should be working very closely, which we are doing right now for example, to make the domestic self-production as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's our domestic self-production has been on the plan right now, and we are expecting like 10% of SAF will be delivered by 2030. And also looking at overseas, for example, the United States case, they have multiple options for supporting the industry and then also the new technology companies like yourself and 1.5. For example, like DOE, DAC have a grant, and also that Inflation Reduction Act, RIA. Those supports will be necessary, I believe, to continue our journey to decarbonization.
Absolutely. You really need the combination the supportive environment in order to commercialize these new technologies together with leading customers like yourselves who are showing that there is a market demand.
In my own words, the opportunities are we have powerful partners like 1.5 and Carbon Engineering who are willing to support our decarbonization journeys towards 2030 and 2050. And as we previously mentioned, the decarbonization in the aviation sector can only be done through a combination of different measures. And we, for our own effort, we have been doing our best to minimize the use of our jet fuel during our regular operations. And we're encouraging our pilots not to use extra fuel during their flight, as long as the safety permits. And also, we have been very active in introducing low carbon fuels, such as sustainable aviation fuel. But the only missing part was the countermeasure towards the zero emissions. So now we're very happy to have this solution coming from 1.5 and Carbon Engineering. And the risks we are recognizing are we need to have more social awareness of various technologies. We spent a lot of energy in promoting new type of fuel, which is sustainable aviation fuel, in our home market. So before we introduced this new type of jet fuel, almost nobody was aware that the technology is there. So I think it is airlines' role to make a big voice and raise the social awareness of new technologies, and also tell our valued customers that we have solution to tackle with the climate challenges.
I can see how that would be very important. I know as someone who gets on an airplane myself, I'm very cognizant of my desire for needing to be in different places in the world or wanting to be connected with my family, I want to be able to do so in an environmentally responsible manner.
Yes.
And I think investments like ANA has made go a long way to helping passengers to feel that they are making a positive difference while they're flying.
Yes. So I would say that our role is to realize our corporate vision, uniting the world in wonder by promoting decarbonization. And in the past few years, safety and health is our top priority that is delivered to our customer. But now the pandemic is over, phasing out, and the next challenge is to how to tackle with climate change and how to prove that aviation industry have the solution to work on this huge topic.
I love that focus on solutions.
Yeah.
It's easy to get discouraged if we only think about the problems.
Yes.
But to be able to present solutions, I think, is very powerful.
Yes. We're proud that we are connecting people and we are connecting goods that needs to be delivered. Mm-hmm. And we cannot give up our mission to continue this role. And to do that, we need solution. That can actually work towards our climate challenges.
I know one of the challenges with sustainable aviation fuel is the ability to scale it and to find the right feedstocks for it. I know one of the future feedstocks for sustainable aviation fuel mm-hmm. could be atmospheric carbon dioxide. Mm-hmm. Could you speak to how you might see those investments being complementary, how you can invest in carbon removals today mm-hmm. as a way of growing your feedstock for sustainable aviation fuel for tomorrow?
Mm-hmm. Through the realization of carbon recycling model, I think it's going to be really important to reutilize the carbon to our source of energy. So of course that can direct air capture technology can work to directly reduce our emissions, also can help to provide our future energy.
Can you share what is ANA's future promise?
Our action is closely aligned with our corporate management vision, which is uniting the world in wonder. And to do that, I think we will have to develop our business in an environmentally friendly manner so that we can meet the requirements from our valued customers and the requirements from society.
You know, one of the things that we often hear from airlines is that they are waiting to see SAF production come online. Mm. ANA has chosen to take action. And I think that's incredibly bold and brave. Can you speak to why it's so important for ANA to take action today rather than simply waiting for solutions to become available?
So, of course, SAF is very important for us for the longer term commitment. And we are also working on expanding the SAF production in Japan as well. But we need to focus on other things that we can do right now. So the one is, one of the options was direct air capture, like negative emission technologies. So as we explained, the portfolio for decarbonization is very important. We do not have one solution, right? So that's why while we are working on SAF production encouragement, we are also taking action for creating and exploring the multiple options to decarbonize. So that's what we are doing right now.
And can you speak about what drew you to carbon removal from direct air capture technology as part of your portfolio?
Okay, so I recognize that there are various projects in the carbon credit market, but what we wanted is a touch of the project. What we value is the permanency of the carbon removals project and also the scalability that fits with the size of our appetite in the decarbonization future in the aviation industry, and also the transparency. So we have that kind of certain criteria for selecting the technologies, and the direct air capture technology was the perfect solution to meet all these three criteria we require.
Can you tell us a little bit about what your biggest learnings were in the process of buying carbon removal? It's not like buying jet fuel, which is something that airlines do every day. It's mm-hmm. not something that's tangible. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us about what you learned from buying carbon removal?
With showing our partnership with 1.5 and carbon engineering yourself, we can show the world that, and also the industry that we have solution. So even though we are, it's said to have limited solutions, however, if you look into it, we have a solution. So let's make a difference.
Everything about what we have discussed already in between carbon engineering 1.5 and ANA was a learning curve. And of course, sustainable aviation fuel is part of our jet fuel where we have knowledge already. But direct air capture is a totally new technology to us. So when we firstly heard the concept about direct air capture, to be very frankly, I thought it's going to be a science fiction. And I also thought that it's going to be the technology in 2030s, 2040s. But when we firstly visited your R&D facility in Squamish, I thought it's the technology available today. So that was the biggest finding for myself personally.
Wonderful. And we're so glad that you had a chance to come and visit in Squamish. I know ANA doesn't buy anything they haven't seen. So
yeah, that's our policy.
You know, I think what I hear from you is that for an airline to have a leadership position in the world and to continue to grow and to connect your customers, it's critically important to also have climate solutions. Am I getting that right?
Yeah, exactly. And I can say what we are selling is not the air ticket. What we are delivering is innovation and the new style in travel experiences. And challenging something new is at the core of our company spirit. And as you might recall, we were the first airline that introduced next generation aircraft, which is a Boeing 787 here. And also, in the old days, we were the first airline that introduced in-flight TV program in the aircraft in the world. So challenging something new is a really exciting one, and that fits with our company culture.
Yeah.
And now I'm very pleased to have the new technology in this climate challenges space. And I'm very proud to have direct air capture in our portfolio today.
Satoko-san and Kohei-san, thank you so much for joining me today. It's such a pleasure to be here with you.